Hey, good morning, church. Good morning. Man, I am so excited to be with you guys this morning. Cannot wait to get into today's message. Before we get into the message, I did want to share something with you. I was thinking about this morning. Really is more of a message of thankfulness. You know, this week I'm going to get a chance to hang out with some other pastors from around the nation at a little short pastor's retreat here locally. And every time I get to do that, I get really excited, and it's fun, and it's relaxing and refreshing and encouraging. But something that always happens that it reflects is when you get to talk with pastors, and being a pastor is a unique time and a unique place during this season, there are so many pastors who really, they have this weird relationship with their church congregation. Like, they're semi, I don't know if this is the best word, but they're like semi scared of them. Like, they're scared of their own church members. Because thinking about preaching and teaching and like coming, like there's so much anxiety. And part of it is because a lot of trauma and wounds and betrayal and hurt and rejection, like those things all happen. And that builds up if you don't take it to Jesus. And it gets to the point where they're like, man, I get nervous every time I have to speak because I'm afraid someone's going to get upset or someone's going to get offended or someone's going to get whatever. And I was thinking about it just this morning, how much I love the opportunity to come to church together with you every Sunday, and how much I look forward to getting to share the Word of God with you. Like, it is not a thing that I take for granted, nor is it a thing that I think is a small, light thing. It is something that I value your trust in, and whether there's one person in this room or 1,000 people in this room, it matters to me that we get to see Jesus in this moment. And so I just want to thank you for who you are, for your partnership, for being here, for being in this place, for helping create a community of believers that focuses on walking in the truth of who Christ is. I think that's huge and such an awesome thing. So give yourself a round of applause this morning. You should just go ahead. You guys are amazing. I love you guys. I'm very thankful. Hey, we're continuing our series called Formed. This is week 26 of this series where we've been walking through and asking ourselves the question, what does it look like to attend to our personal spiritual formation, to have our lives transformed and become aware of God's presence in every area of our life? We've been looking at verses like Romans chapter 12, verse 2, where it says, don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And looking at how we live in the way that Jesus asks us to in Mark chapter 12, verse 30, where he says, you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And man, it's been such a really incredible time of studying, of journeying, of walking through. And as we're getting closer and closer to the end of this particular series or study, it's just amazing to see the fruitfulness of what God's doing in the church as a whole and in the individuals and in individual lives. And it's such a really cool thing to be in. And, you know, there's something that is I want to talk about today, kind of when we walk out this practicality of what it looks like, looking at some of the teachings from Jesus. And, you know, we are called, and we talked about this a little last week, to live and to love differently than the world. That we are supposed to look different than the people who are around us. We've been studying about the devil, the flesh, and the world, and our part of resisting those things. And we are supposed to be different. And you know, we find ourselves right in the middle in many times where we have the devil with his deceptive ideas or lies, the author of lies, and then being people who are living in the world with its things that it justifies as okay, and it makes completely normal and standardized in our society. And we find ourselves here in the middle of those two things, in the process of dealing with our own self and our own flesh in the middle of this process. And it's a hard place to find yourself. But Jesus has some interesting teachings, some interesting verses on what it looks like. We've talked about what does it look like to live like Jesus and look differently. And in Matthew chapter 5, verse 40, it says, 44, it says, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Luke chapter 6, verse 28 says, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Matthew 26, 52 says, put the sword back in its place. For those who draw the sword will die by the sword. Or we've kind of changed it to, if you live by the sword, you die by the sword. And then this last verse I want to highlight this morning, it says, James 1:19, it says, understand this, my dear brothers and sisters, you must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. When I read all of those verses, and I think about them, I find myself naturally being completely opposite to everything that it just said. Like, especially that one in James where it's like, quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. I find myself the exact opposite. Quick to speak, quick to speak, very slow to listen, and I get angry really quickly. I find myself the exact opposite. I think that's probably our culture. I don't see many people who are really on Instagram or on Twitter or on, you know, social media, like just living out that James 1:19 verse in their life. We typically are very quick to get inflamed, very quick to get angry, very quick to share our mind, and very slow to listen to anyone else's point of view, ideas, or thoughts. This is like the culture that we live in. But all of those things, praying for those who mistreat you, loving your enemy, right? As opposed to living by justice, instead living by mercy. Like these ideas are things that we see in the life of Jesus that he invites us to follow him in. That our little test, our little litmus test that we can look at ourselves and say, how closely am I following Jesus? How often does my soul reflect these things in hard times? In difficult times, when I'm under pressure. We all know it's really easy to live life and to act and behave a certain way, but then sometimes when things like outside pressures come, you may change a little bit. Like I can find myself being very kind and patient and loving where we have no place to go. But the moment that we have to be somewhere, I become a different person. Because there is a time, and I value time. Everyone else in my family doesn't, I think. I'm convinced that they're against me, all of them. They're all against me. And so it's me against the world to get anywhere. And I've told you how I'm sometimes dramatic. Like, and I take one little thing, and then, like, I play it out in my mind how it goes to the worst thing. It's like we start off by being late to school, and then my kids get detention, and then my kids get kicked out of school, and then they become addicted to heroin, and then they're homeless for the rest of their life, and I just ended the whole family line because I was late to school. And I know that's, like, ridiculous, and you're out there, like, take a chill. But, like, this is it. So, like, I can be very kind and prayerful and peaceful and, like, whatever when we're just, like, lazing around on Saturday. But then when we actually have to be somewhere, I all of a sudden am not. When there's pressure, what comes out when there's pressure? What comes out of your actions when it's hard? When there's stress? When there's conflict? What comes out of your mouth, what comes out of your heart, what comes out of your actions. And I can tell you, you can start to feel like you're doing pretty good until you get into a difficult situation. And that shouldn't put you to a place of guilt and condemnation. What it should do is drive you back to the realization of how much we need Jesus in our life. How he's not done with me yet. I'm not there yet. Now, praise God, I'm not where I was, right? Like, I don't know if you remember, but sometimes it's good to remember where you were. Sometimes I remember where I was 5, 10 years ago. Sometimes my wife reminds me where I was. No, I'm just kidding. 5, 10 years ago. And I'm, like, thankful. Man, I'm so glad I'm not there anymore. I'm so glad I'm not there anymore. But I'm not where I'm supposed to be. I'm not where God is leading me to. And that's okay. That's part of the journey. And I'm going to look at some of that journey today because we're in this process. I want to read this passage in Mark chapter 8, verse 34. Because what we're talking about here in this whole form series is the idea of being disciples or to be an apprentice or a follower of Jesus. Not just someone who accepts salvation, like the salvation, it was the free gift of salvation that is through the grace of Jesus Christ. You believe and you are saved, the eternity is there. He was the propitiation for our sins on the cross, like all that is there. But there's this invitation in this process to not just be saved by Christ, but to be transformed by Christ. To be an apprentice, to learn from him. And what he says in Mark chapter 8, 34, he says, then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple, my apprentice, my follower, to learn to live like me, must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Three things. Deny themselves, and take up their cross, and follow me. These three things. Now, I'm going to be really honest with you. I don't particularly like all three of those things. My nature, my human flesh, denying myself. That is the exact opposite of what we as a society are living for. We're supposed to be living for self-gratification, self-fulfillment, self-realization, self-actualization, not self-denial. I hate that. And then there's this business of like taking up my cross. The cross is death. I don't like that either. And the third one, which is the least offensive, which is Jesus saying, follow me. On paper, I'm like, yes, Jesus. But then I'm reminded of things like, I don't get to choose where I want to go, or when I want to go, or how fast I want to go. And then I think of like, even though you lead me through the valley of the shadow of death, why are you leading me through the valley of the shadow of death? I don't want to go there. Yeah, you make me lie down between, that's good, but let's get back to that valley of the shadow of death part that you led me through. Not cool. If I was leading myself, I would avoid that area. I'd just stay in that green pastures you talked about. So we have this verse, and when you hear this verse, I don't know about you, there's something inside of me that just says like, nah, I don't like that. I don't like it. I don't like any of it. And we've been talking about this voice. We've called it many things. It's the flesh. It's the old man. It's the self. And so in this process, we are called to deny ourselves, to take up our cross, and to follow him. Now this, by the way, you're not the first person. This isn't a modern thing like, oh, it's because you have Instagram that you don't like it. Right after this, it said like half of or more, almost everyone left Jesus. Everyone loved Jesus when it was like free bread and free wine and free fish and healings for everyone and you get a miracle and you get a miracle and you get a miracle. Everyone followed Jesus then. But every single gospel has an instance of saying something like this, where it's like you have to deny yourself and to take up your cross and follow me. You need to die to yourself. You need to eat me and to live. Like you need, like there's this example over and over again. And every single time, the result was everyone being like, ah, oh, never mind, I'm out. I like the miracles, I like the free food, I like the meals, I like the stuff, like that was good, but now you just hit something and I don't like it. And they left. So when you hear something like this and your initial reaction is like, it's not for me. You find yourself in the company of those who came before you and the company of those who will come after you. So we've got these things, and so I want to talk about it. So first of all, the cross. We're going to see this in a second. We are not talking about a physical death. There's been people throughout history who've gotten confused, and they sometimes take these analogies and they try to bring them to like the very fullest example, like people who will literally harm themselves or do really crazy things because they want to be more like Christ. Like I read the story about this guy who wanted to be a saint, and so he ended up piercing his own hands and feet so he could be more like Jesus. Don't do that. That's stupid. Let me just make sure I get that out of there. This is not saying, hey, you guys should all just take up a cross. This is not saying you need to carry a cross everywhere you go. This is not the justification for the cross. If you have a cross, this is great. I don't care. Okay? That's not what it's talking about. It is talking about death to self, to the flesh. And it's pointing to what Christ was going to do for us physically. He was going to do in the physical realm what we cannot do in the physical realm, but he also did it in the spiritual realm so that we could have access to it in the spiritual realm. That though he was man and tempted with everything, he never sinned. Death to self. Not my will, but your will be done, God. Death to self. He He gave us an example. So he says we're supposed to deny ourselves. Now, let me tell you what we're supposed to deny. Sometimes this gets confused and people think, oh, God just wants a bunch of autonomous robots who all look the same, have the same, talk the same, drink the same, like that's all the same. No. The very picture of God, the Trinity, is the idea of unity and diversity. That diversity is beautiful. That he created diversity. Look at our world and the creation. He did not create one type of animal and one type of food and one type of tree. He created thousands and thousands of them to show you the diversity that he believes is good. And he created your personality to be different. We are not the same. There's some people who are loud. There's some people who are quiet. There's introverts. There's extroverts. There's all sorts of different things that people talk about in your Enneagram and your Myers-Briggs and your whatever. Like, that's all. Listen, it is not telling you to deny yourselves. Like, you should just not be a funny person anymore. Be somber. That's not what it's talking about. It's not time. In fact, those are the things in how God made you. You were fearfully and wonderfully made. You were knitted together in your mother's womb. He breathed the spirit inside of you. You have that in you. You are not called to be like the person who sits to your left and right. You are called to be you. And when we are denying ourselves, we're not denying the way that God has you. We're literally, strictly speaking, to the thing that we do have in common, which is our desire to do what is right, to choose what is good and bad in our own eyes, the flesh. We are supposed to deny that ourselves is the gateway to salvation. Yourself is not the gateway to success, to salvation. Your actions are not the gateway to salvation. The choices that you make other than the choice you make in Christ is not the access to salvation. That is Jesus. And so, when I deny that I am the Savior, while accepting that I'm beautifully made, and then I take up my cross saying, I'm going to actually crucify that thought. And in doing so, accept the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, that he is the salvation for me. I then find myself on this journey of what Jesus says, follow me. Two words that mean more than we could ever talk about here in church, more than we'll ever experience in our entire lifetime. Follow me. That was the call he gave to all the disciples, right? When he looked at them and he said, put down your nets and follow me. Follow me. Follow me. Like that, sometimes we make it too complicated and too difficult and we try to create processes and systems, but in the end, what he's asking you to do is follow him. Deny that you have the answer. And in fact, allow yourself to die. We see this here in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, where Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. Remember, this is just figurative. He's clearly alive. He's writing it. But Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. He keeps going on in chapter 5 a little later. He says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. So he says, like, I've chosen that I am not the way, but he's the way. And I've chosen that this thing, this flesh, I've crucified it with Christ. Because now I am living not in the power of myself, but I'm living in the power of Jesus and the Spirit in me. And he asked me to follow him. To follow him. Listen to this in John chapter 10, verse 7. So Jesus said to them again, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. Now this is good. And maybe this is because I've been reading about Christmas stuff here recently. But the door, like this door, like it's not just talking about like a pin and a gate, like it's great, like that's good, we understand there's a door and we're going to keep reading about it. And before they talked about more doors and they were confused, this is a great chapter. John chapter 10 is great. Ladies, you'll get there at some point in your Bible study. But this door is talking about what they talked about in Hosea, where he said that I am sending you a door of hope. that you can walk through, that you can be hopeless on one side, but a door of hope opens and you can walk through that door. And that is not a physical door, it is a person in Jesus. That is, there is a doorway to hope, that you can be hopeless on one side and completely overwhelmingly full of hope on the other. He said, I'm the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, to kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and life abundantly. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays his life down for the sheep. He lays out this invitation. There is a way to follow him. And he gives a picture that maybe we're not the most familiar with, but it's the idea of a shepherd. We talk about this a lot. We were very removed from the idea of sheep and livestock and all that, this kind of thing. And we probably have sheep now, but they probably have like GPS trackers or something on them now. Like, we don't even do it the same anymore. It's like all automated or something. But here's the thing. He says, you will walk through the door and find pasture. You allow yourself to be led by the shepherd. The shepherd. The shepherd, the one who says, here's where you go. This is like this complete picture that we won't have time to fully get into today. But he is the protector. He is the provider. He's the leader. He's the comforter. He's the healthcare giver. He's the wet, like he's the nurse who delivers these babies. Like, he is everything to the sheep. And the sheep know all they have to do to thrive is follow him. That's it. When he says go, go. When he says stay, stay. To follow him. And that even if it doesn't look right, even if it looks a little scary, even if it looks a little thing that we want to hesitate, when he says go, we trust the shepherd. Now again, even in this example, it can be hard for you and I, because I don't like to think of myself as a dumb sheep. I like to think of myself as something more glorious than that, something with more self-determination than that, something more powerful than that, not something that will literally follow another one off a cliff. And yet, that is the example. Because these pictures is everything about surrendering myself to him. Surrendering myself to him. And we get this invitation. We can either allow him to lead us to the path and through your journey. Remember, we are on a lifetime journey with Christ. We talked about it earlier, the compound interest. I don't care what my return is tomorrow. I'm in the journey of following him for my life. My life, my lifetime of following. And in that process, as I walk through, I do this, I get to see the result of great choices. I get to see the result of following him. I get to see the result of saying yes to him. But the opposite remains true. When you say no to him, you open yourself up to deception, to lies, to darkness. Like, those are the things. That is the result of saying no. But there's this amazing thing. Every time you say yes to something, by the very nature of it, you are saying no to hundreds, if not thousands, of other things. That's how life works, right? Sometimes it can maybe a binary one or the other, but most times in life, when you say yes to go to dinner with some friends on Friday night, by the very nature, you are saying no to the infinite other possibilities of what you could have done on Friday night, correct? We talk about this at church all the time. Like, we are a church, we have a staff, we have resources, we have money, we have things, we have limited things. We can only say yes to so many things, because every time we say yes, it takes away resources, and every yes means a no to something else. When we say yes to Christ, we are saying yes to certain things, but by the same time, we are saying no to other things. When I tell Christ I'm going to follow him with my life, when I lay my life down to Christ, I'm saying yes to that, but it means saying no to other things. It's hard to try to understand that we sometimes want to keep things. And here's the result for people who are here. When we find ourselves in this place of following Jesus, this is the hesitation that most of us have. It's not impossible. It happens, but it's not the most common thing. It is rare that you find someone who's in a relationship with God. They love God. They're following after him with his whole heart. And then all of a sudden, one day, they just decide, never mind. Forget it. I don't want to do this anymore. It sometimes happens. But it's not the most common thing. I'll tell you what is far more common. Is an example of what we can maybe see in whether it was historically accurate or it's just a myth that was passed down. It's something that came from a little dark time in church history, which would be like the Crusade times, right? It was not a great time in church history. And there was these different militant groups who were created because they believed the best way to share the love of Jesus Christ was to kill anyone who disagreed. Bad choice. Not the best idea. So there was different groups that were formed. And one of the groups that was formed was called the Knights Templar. Maybe you've heard of them. They're kind of like these, like, they're kind of fun because they're knights and they have swords and they're powerful and, like, they, you know, do stuff. Like, and it was like, whatever. Like, we can kind of, you know, look at this and think, oh, that's kind of cool. And then you remember, like, oh, they were doing that with the name of Jesus. That's probably not as cool. So one of the things that they were said to have done, whether it's just fiction or it was historically accurate, is before they went into battle, they would all get baptized. But when they would get baptized, they would have their sword in their hand and they would fully submerge themselves, everything except the sword. Like saying, yeah, God, take all of me, just not this. Just not my violence. Just not what I'm about to do with this. Now, by today, you probably don't own a sword. Maybe some of you do. I know there's some katana collectors out there. Everyone wants a katana. But we find ourselves in this process of following me. When Jesus says, follow me, we say, yes, Lord. Baptize me, Lord. And then we're like, just not this. Just not my debit card. There's certain things I really like to buy. You know, just not my decision on what's morally right or wrong in sex. Just my relationships. You can have all of me except that relationship. I like to keep that one. Thank you. Past wounds. I don't want to get rid of that wound. I know you said you came to heal me. I like that one broken. Thank you. I like to go back to that place. It makes me feel, ugh. Reminds me of my emo youth. Don't take that one. Maybe it's an entertainment habit. Maybe it's even a political or maybe even a theological view or stance. Yeah, take everything but that. I gotta keep that one. I like that one. We find that in this process of denying ourselves, taking up our cross, and following him, in our journey, we keep on holding on to certain things. We hold on. We hold on. We all do it. Sometimes it's for good reasons, sometimes it's for bad reasons. But then when we find another passage like Mark chapter 8:35, where he says, for whoever wants to save their life, the Greek word is actually soul, will lose it. But whoever loses their life, their soul, for me and for the gospel, will save it. Jesus gives this idea that, and you got to think about this for a minute. It sounds great, like it's like poetic, but you got to think, Jesus would often, when he finished a teaching, He usually didn't finish teachings with a, now I'm going to give you the 10 things you need to go do to make this happen. Or I'm going to give you a command for what you do. What he often finished teachings with was a statement of fact that usually had some kind of binary outcome, a yes or a no. What he says is, in here, if you read it, I want to tell you something. You will lose your life. It wasn't an option. You will lose your life. Now, if you try to save your own life, you will lose it. Because in saving your own life, you are defining what's good and bad, and you therefore have decided to do what is right in your own eyes. You are walking in sin, and the wages of sin is death. You will lose your life. He said, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, will save it. Whoever lets go of everything will therefore, as the result of not determining what's good and bad in their own eyes, therefore allowing him to determine what's good and bad, will be like a tree planted along a river who produces fruit in every season, because you are no longer walking through the path of sin. You are walking through the path of life that he has. But the cost is the same as sin. Your life. Your life. And what he gives in this process is something so amazing. He gives us a choice. It's expounded here in Luke chapter 14, verse 27. He says, and whoever does not carry their cross, here it is again, oh man, and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and wasn't able to finish. I feel this one like a lot in my soul, probably because of our building history. Even though it wasn't my choice, and it wasn't Pastor Mike's choice, like people drove past this place and like, look at those idiots. They started something, they couldn't finish it. What poor planning. But he gives us an invitation. He gives you an invitation that is this idea of it's okay to understand that you can perform what we would call modernly a cost-benefit analysis. Everything has a cost, and then there's a benefit. We do this all the time, whether you knew it or not. You look at how much something costs, you think about the benefit, and you weigh out, is the cost worth the benefit? This thing is $10, this thing is $15. Does the benefit outweigh the $5 difference? Sometimes the answer is yes. When it comes to really good coffee, it's worth it. Trust me. Sometimes the answer is no. But we get to look at this cost-benefit analysis. Now, when we think about our relationship with Christ and we think about cost-benefit analysis, our instant reaction, the thing that your flesh wants to do, what your mind is supposed to do is like, ah, now I got to cost account all the things that I don't get to do that are fun anymore as a sacrifice to Jesus. And then I guess I'll say it was worth it to follow him. I won't be able to do this or do this or watch this or smoke this or drink this. Yes, the cost. Then that's my cross that I will carry, and then therefore I followed him. You're welcome for my sacrifice for you, Jesus. You're welcome. But I don't actually think that's what Jesus is telling you. You know, cost-benefit goes both ways. What if instead of costing of what we're not doing, that maybe at one point of our life we kind of enjoyed doing, why don't we actually count the cost of not following him? What if we looked at the idea of what it means to count the cost to not be in relationship with him? And there's a lot of things that we can look at. If we were to sacrifice long-term happiness for short-term pleasure, that's a cost. Is the benefit of short-term pleasure now better than the long-term happiness that I find living a life that Christ has invited me to into following him? How about truth and reality right now that I can find through his word and through his scripture and through his definition of who I am and who I'm called to be and what is right and wrong? The truth and reality, I could exchange it for autonomy and doing it my own way. I lose one for the other. Can't have both. You can't have truth and reality and do it your own way and be apart. They are separate. They are impossible. You can convince yourself I can have both. And in fact, you can convince yourself I can find truth and reality on my own, doing my own thing. But you will find yourself in complete unreality, separated from truth. I can give up the hope of love for a fleeting sexual encounter. I can give up the intimacy and trust of marriage for the thrill and the danger of an affair. I can be content with what I have, or I can get the exhilaration of buying something new. I can see the results of following Jesus as well as I can, and in the grace of Him every day, in the long-term results of what it does in my heart and my soul and my mind and every part of me. Or I can see the very easy option of quitting when things get hard. There's always a cost. There's always a cost. No decisions are made in vacuum. And though we can lie to ourselves and fool ourselves that this won't affect anything, this won't hurt anyone, this won't change anything, this will keep me the same, there is always a cost. Because in your yes, there are no's. And in your no's, there's the opportunity for yeses. And Jesus invites us in a loving way that is unfathomable to deny that you have the right answers, to give up on your works to find justification, to instead accept His works as your justification and follow Him. Follow Him. Mark 1:15, one of Jesus' earliest sermons that was an echo of many sermons that came before Him. The time has come, He said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. If you want to know a little more modern translation, it would be rethink everything you know to be good and bad. Rethink everything that you thought was right and wrong. Rethink all of your life's decisions. Rethink all of it in your mind. Have your mind renewed. And trust about this good news that I'm coming to not just tell you about, but to actually live out, which is there's grace and forgiveness of sins found in Jesus Christ. Change your mind. Renew your mind. And be transformed. There was an author, very early church leader, named Ignatius. And I love, he has, we don't know a lot about him. He was in the first or second century. Very early follower of Christ. And we have some of his letters. I love what he wrote as his definition of sin. He said, sin is the unwillingness to trust that what God wants for me is only my deepest happiness. The unwillingness to trust that He only wants your deepest happiness. The lie is He's keeping something from you. Did He really say not to eat that? He's keeping something. He's keeping a joy. He's keeping a pleasure. He's keeping a knowledge. He's keeping an intimacy. He's keeping something from you. That is when we believe that lie and we act on that impulse, that is the result of sin. You chose to not believe that he has your deepest happiness at heart. And so when we walk in this process of following Christ, and we come against things that maybe our flesh would want to do, or the world says it's okay, or the devil is whispering in your ear that it's totally fine, everybody does it. This will make you like God. You can remind yourself. His deepest purpose is for me to find something so much better in him. So much better in him. I just get to follow him. And I may not be where I want to be, but I love the greeting from Paul in Philippians 1:6, where he says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. He is working. He is working. And here's the promise that we have. We say it, we sing it in songs. If it's not finished, then he's still working. Because he will work until completion. He's not man that he should lie or grow tired or weary. He will keep working on you. He will keep molding you and forming you and transforming you and inviting you deeper and deeper into his love and to his mercy and grace and allowing you to see him more and more clearly every single day. And we get this process of just saying, I'm going to follow you. I'm not going to follow me. I'm not going to follow the world. I'm not going to follow the deceptions of the devil. I am going to listen to the voice of my shepherd, and the voice of the stranger I will not hear, because there's a doorway to hope. There's one who desires my deepest happiness and contentment, who brings peace. And when faced with a decision, as opposed to thinking about, oh, what if only I could do that, or if only I could go back to that, I can count the cost and say, you know what? The thing that I'm gaining by following Christ far outweighs what I am giving up. And the fruit of the Spirit is at work in my life, confirming these things every day. So I take one more step on this journey, and one more step again. And at some point, I'll turn around and realize how far I came. And maybe even have a few memories along the way. But the invitation is always to come back and follow me. Follow me. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your invitation. We thank you for the desire you have for us to live lives that are full of your goodness and your purpose and your vision. With every head bowed for just a moment, if you're here and you've never accepted Jesus, I want to give you a chance to do it. It's as simple as saying a prayer. I'm going to ask everyone to repeat this prayer after me. Say, Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for me so my sins could be forgiven, so my heart could be set free, so I could follow you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. With every head bowed for just a moment, if you made a decision to accept Jesus today, anywhere in the room, would you just raise your hand up real high? If you're online, they're going to put a phone number up on the screen that you can text and get connected with our prayer team. All right, if there's any hands up, they can go down. Father, for everyone else who's here today, thank you that your grace and your mercy is new every morning. That you are faithful to complete what you started. That when we fall down, you help us get right back up. That you are our guide and our shepherd. Help us follow you. Help us follow you. Help us see the goodness of living a life in oneness with you. It's in Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, church, we love you so much. We love you so much. Don't forget, Daughters Tuesday is going to be absolutely incredible. You are loved and prayed for. We will see you next week. Have a great rest of your day.